Hi, this is MD Shabana Sultana, working as an associate professor in the Chebrol Engineering College. Today, I want to discuss about the types of corrosion. In the last lecture, I told about the series of corrosion, which are of two types. They are wet theory of corrosion and the dry theory of corrosion. Next, coming to the types of corrosion, we will discuss now. How many types of corrosions are there? Based on the mechanism of the corrosions are of many types. In that, the first one is a galvanic corrosion. This galvanic corrosion is also known as differential metal corrosion. And the second one is a differential adhesion corrosion. Third one is a stress corrosion. And coming to the fourth type of corrosion, which is known as waterline corrosion. Coming to the first one, which is known as the galvanic corrosion or the differential metal corrosion. Differential metal, that means the name itself indicates they are two dissimilar metals. When they are electrically connected and exposed to an electrolyte, then the metal which are higher in the electrochemical series, it undergo corrosion first. So this type of corrosion is known as galvanic corrosion. This galvanic corrosion occur when the metal possesses the higher oxidation potential or higher in the electrochemical series, it becomes anode and it undergo the corrosion. For example, if you take the zinc and the copper, which are connected and exposed to the corroding environment. Corroding environment means it contains the moisture, which acts as an electrolyte. Then zinc becomes anode because of higher oxidation potential or higher position in the electrochemical series. And zinc undergo oxidation and corrodes. Whereas copper undergo reduction with the absorption of the electrons, which are comes from the anode, and they are protected. The electron released by the zinc reaches the copper through the metal. So, this galvanic corrosion occurs when the two metals are in contact with each other in the presence of moisture. The metal which is having the less reduction potential, it undergoes oxidation and gets corroded. And the metal which is having the high reduction potential, it undergoes reduction and it is being protected. So this is the example of the differential metal corrosion. When the metal is in contact, aluminium is in contact with the copper, in the presence of the moisture, aluminium undergo the oxidation because it is having the less reduction potential. It undergo oxidation more easily and it is get corroded, whereas the copper becomes inert. Coming to the working of the of these two anode and cathodic region, at the anode, this aluminium, it is converted into its aluminium ion, Al plus 3, with the liberation of 3 electrons, which passes from aluminium to copper, where it becomes reacted with the moisture, that is a water molecule, and the oxygen. And there, the formation of the hydroxyl ion takes place. This hydroxyl ions is react with the aluminium ion which is in the ionic form, aluminium, which is in the ionic form, these two gets reacted with each other, or it undergoes the reaction and forms aluminium hydroxide. So this is about the differential metal corrosion. Whereas coming to the second type of corrosion, which is known as differential aeration corrosion, the different ways of creating the differential aeration on the metal surface, which are partial immersion of the metal in the solution, faulty design of the equipment, and accumulation of the dirt, sand, scales, and other contaminations, pitching corrosion is also there, and corrosion which is caused due to the caustic embrittlement. And in this, underground corrosion is also takes place, which comes under the differential aeration corrosion. This type of corrosion occur when the same metal is exposed to different air concentration. In the formal type of corrosion, which is known as a differential metal corrosion, two different metals we will take in the same atmospheric conditions. But in this type of corrosion, when same metal is exposed to different air concentration due to the formation of oxygen concentration gradient, OCG, this causes a difference in the potential between differently aerated area. The metal which is in contact with more oxygen will act as a cathode. The less oxygenated part of the metal, it acts as an anode. Suppose if we take the zinc rod. And it is immersed deeply in the NaCl solution. See here, this is an example. This is a zinc rod, and if it is immersed deep in the NaCl solution, the zinc rod above the NaCl solution is acts as a cathode, because the oxygen are present in both the areas. The zinc rod which is immersed in the NaCl solution will having the oxygen of less concentration, and this area is known as less oxygenated part. And the rod which are dipped in the less oxygenated part, it acts as an anode. Whereas the zinc rod which is exposed to the more oxygenated area, which is the atmospheric air, which acts as a cathode. And the flow of electron takes place. See here, at the anode, the zinc will get ionized to zinc ion, that is Zn plus 2, with the liberation of electrons. And this electron is flow from anodic part to the cathodic part through the metal. The circuit is completed by the migration of electrons through the electrolyte. As a result, the zinc starts corroding in the anodic area, immersed in the sodium chloride solution. The example for this is a ship hull's storage tanks. See here. The differential aeration of the metal causes the flow of current called the differential current, and oxidation takes place at the anode and get corroded. Differential aeration accounts for the corrosion of the metals partially immersed in the solution just below the water line. So this type of corrosion is also known as water line corrosion, which we will study later. In the waterline corrosion, fourth type of corrosion. So this is a description which I explained here. When the zinc is partially immersed in the dilute solution of a neutral salt, that is NaCl solution, the part above and closely adjacent to the waterline are more aerated, and becomes cathodic. The part immersed shows smaller oxygen concentration and it becomes anodic. So a differential potential is created in that the zinc will dissolve at the anodic area and oxygen will take up the electron at the cathodic area to form hydroxyl ion. See, hydroxyl ion is formed at the cathode by the taking up of the electron at the cathodic area. The circuit is completed by the migration of the ions through the electrolyte and the flow of electron through the metal from the anode to cathode. So this is about the differential aeration corrosion. Coming to the third type of corrosion, which is known as stress corrosion. This stress corrosion, it is formed by the combined effect of the static tensile stress and corrosive environment on the metal. It is highly localized attack occurring when overall corrosion is negligible. And these are the following causes for the stress corrosion to occur. Presence of tensile strength is the main reason for the stress corrosion, majorly seen in the fabricated articles of alloys like high zinc brass and nickel brasses. Heavy working like rolling, drawing, or insufficient annealing produces the stress in the alloys. Pure metal or immune to stress. Localized electrochemical corrosion occur along the grain boundaries and narrow path, forming anodic area, and the remaining part of the metal becomes cathode. The metal undergo ionization at the anode area and electron diffuses through the metal to the cathodic area, producing the hydroxyl ions. The corrosion product is formed between the anodic and cathodic area. The presence of the stress produces, see here, this part is exposed to the stress. The presence of the stress produces high electrode potential and localized zone finally results in the formation of a crack. See here. This is a stress part of the grain boundary where the corrosion takes place and the cracks will form, which grows and propagates until failure occurs. So some of the typical examples of the stress corrosion is season cracking, caustic embrittlement, and the stainless steels are also one of the good examples for this stress corrosion. Coming to the first one, that is the season cracking. In this term is applied to the stress corrosion of alloys, mainly the brasses. And when highly stressed alpha brass undergo intergranular corrosion or intergranular cracking in an atmosphere containing the traces of ammonia or anions. The main reason for the corrosion is a grain boundaries. The grain boundary is where the metals is sensitive to corrosion attack. The corrosive attacking liquid or reagent possesses the character of only attacking at the grain boundaries. The grain boundaries contains the material which shows the electrode potential more anodic at the grain boundary, and the precipitation of certain compounds at the grain boundary produces a solid solution depleted in one constituent, making the grain boundary anodic. The metal at the grain boundary decay as it becomes anodic, and at the center of the grain becomes cathodic, which is protected. The electron flows from anodic to cathodic area through the metal. The ion formed at the cathode and the anode area moves in the center of these two areas where the corrosion products are formed. The typical example of this corrosion is that the welding of stainless steel is done by the deposition of the chromium carbide at the grain boundary, which makes the grain boundary anodic and corrosion occur. So that is about the season cracking. Coming to the caustic embrittlement, it is a form of stress corrosion occur in the mild steel exposed to alkali solution at high temperature and stress. This is associated with the steam boilers in which water of high alkalinity attack the mild steel plates at high pressure. Next, coming to the in the caustic embrittlement also, the boilers feed water contain certain amount of sodium carbonate, which decomposes to sodium hydroxide under the high pressure of the boilers, which deposits in the head racks, pits, etc. of the broiler plate, creating a concentration cell. The metal deposited with NaOH, it becomes anodic, while the metal surrounded the drop becomes cathodic. So this is the example of the caustic embrittlement, which is formed in the mild steel plates. Next, coming to the last type of corrosion, which is known as waterline corrosion. When the water is stored in the steel tank, it is generally found that maximum amount of the corrosion takes place along the line just beneath the level of the water meniscus. The area above the water line, which is exposed to the more oxygen concentration, it acts as a cathode. In the previous example, I already discussed when the zinc rod, when it is dipped in the NaCl solution, because of the oxygen, difference in the oxygen concentration between these two states, that means the oxygen concentration is more above the water line, it acts as a cathode and is completely unaffected by corrosion. The part of the metal below the water line, it acts as an anode. In case of the ship hulls, the waterline corrosion is accelerated by marine plants attaching themselves to the sides of the ships. The use of special anti-fouling paints to the ship will restrict this type of corrosion. Next, coming to the passivity of the metal. The process in which the metal or an alloy exhibit higher corrosion resistance, either by itself or by coating a very thin, invisible and highly protective film on the surface, is called passivity. The passivity, the word itself indicates that it is completely anonymous to the activity. opposite to that of the activity. That means the activity of the metal is stopped either by itself or by coating with a very thin invisible or highly protective film on the surface of the metal, which decreases the reactivity of the metal, which is known as passivity. This thin film is insoluble and it is passive. And it is passive to certain environment. Its corrosion rate is very low. And with a change of the environment also, the passivity of the metal may change and may become active towards the corrosion. It all depends upon the electrode potential of the coated metal and the pH of the medium. For example, if we take the low carbon steel, which does not corrode, even if it is reactive to the concentrated nitric acid due to protective effect of the passive film. However, if it is treated with the dilute nitric acid, it does not form a stable passive film and therefore the steel will dissolve. Some of the metal themselves, they form a protective oxide film in the air, water, and in the presence of the dilute acids. For example, if you take the aluminium, tin, titanium, and chromium, these are all passive metals towards the thin films. So in the next lecture, I would like to discuss about the galvanic series. Thank you.